Okay, thank you, Professor, for your incredible patience throughout these
Sorry.
technological adventures.
Yeah.
Okay. So let's jump right in. This is part one, which is the foundations of SCT. SCT. So is SCT exclusive to SLA, or where does it come from?
No, it's not exclusive to SLA. It is a psychological theory, and that was originally proposed by the Russian psychologist L.S. Vygotsky, beginning in the 1920s, mid-20s, and the research on extending it to L2 research began, I would say, in the mid-1980s. And the idea was that if it's a general psychological theory, then it should have something to say about all aspects of human thinking, human consciousness, the human mind. And so we began to explore the possibilities of what the theory brings to understanding the process of learning a second language. And in particular, because the core of the theory is built around language or the activity of languaging or speaking, or including writing. When we talk about speaking, we're also talking about writing.
Now, Piaget and Vygotsky are often taught at the same time in courses of developmental psychology. And but what would be a key assumption that they would not share?
Yeah. First of all, Vygotsky is not a developmental psychologist, as Piaget was. Vygotsky was a psychologist that used development as his methodology, what he called history. And both history backward and history forward. So the idea was that if you want to understand the complexities of human thinking, you had to go back in time to the beginnings of the process and trace its development over time. And so he looked at four different timescales, beginning with phylogenesis, looking at differences between human thinking and animal thinking, primarily primates. And the idea was that humans, and I know this is a question coming up a bit later, but I'll anticipate it. The idea was that humans are animals and not animals at the same time. So we share certain features with animals, instincts that are passed down through our biological histories. But at the same time, we have something different that animals don't have, and that's human culture mediated by symbolic tools, including language is perhaps probably the most powerful symbolic tool, but other tools too, like numbers and music and so on and so forth. Art, Vygotsky was interested in art and so on as a form of cultural mediation, but I'll leave that aside for the moment. So the second time scale that he was interested in was the development of human culture over time and how forms of mediation changed from very simple types of mediation, like using dice or bones in the real, distant past to make decisions as a form of mediating our thinking. Should I do this or should I do that? And the tracing that the development of forms of mediation from, distant past up to modern times. And today we would think about things like iPhones and so on and so forth as forms of mediation or mediating our thinking. The third domain that he was interested in was the development of children. So the ontogenesis of the formation of a contemporary adult. So if you look at adult thinking, it's very hard to separate our biological endowment from our cultural history, right? Because the things are become integrated in adult thinking. That was his argument. And so to find out what the contributions of biology were from separating that out from the contributions of culture, you needed to go back in ontogenetic time to look at the origins of an adult mind. And so you go back to childhood, to infancy. And so he wrote quite a bit about the formation of thinking from infancy, from pretty much birth, up through adolescence into adult life. So, and that made him, that sort of gave people the mistaken idea that he was a developmental psychologist, okay, similar to Piaget, which he was not. So he used development as a way of understanding adult thinking. He was interested in where does adult minds come from, right? Okay. And the final time scale was, of course, microgenesis, where mm-hmm. he looked at the formation of particular capacities over relatively short periods of time, like learning aspects of another language, for example, or learning how to do, becoming creative in school and using your imagination and being taught how to use imagination and creativity in thinking, right? So that's a big difference between Vygotsky and Piaget. The other difference, of course, was that Piaget was, by training, a biologist. And okay. so for him, human thinking, human development was a biological unfolding over time, right? So as adults move, as children move through the various stages from sensory motor operation all the way up to formal operational thinking, that was a relatively smooth biological process. For Vygotsky, which he explains in the introductory chapters to his volume on language and thought, mm-hmm. Comparing him, his theory to Piaget, thinking is not, human adult thinking is not a, just a biological process, it's a cultural process. Mm-hmm. And so he often wrote about the cultural development of the child or the cultural development of the adult. But what he meant by that was not what I think the ordinary person would think of as cultural development.
Yeah.
You know, learning how to behave properly.
That's also one of my questions. Like, in what ways the name sociocultural could be misleading for some people? Like,
yeah. And so what he meant by cultural development was the psychological formation of adult thinking. That's how you need to think about it.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
So he was not a developmental psychologist, and his view of development was very was radically different from Piaget's, which for Piaget was a biological unfolding. For Vygotsky, it was a revolutionary mm-hmm. process that he described as drama. It was a dramatic process okay. that often had conflict and stops and starts, and sometimes going backward in order to go forward. Right. So it's a very different concept of development. So when psychologists today think about development, they generally think about it as a smooth process. And that idea has been brought into SLA, and it shows up in things like developmental sequences mm-hmm. that everybody has to pass through, because that's what our internal system is telling us has to happen. Vygotsky says, no, that's not how I view development. It's actually revolutionary process, mm-hmm. right? That's driven by culture,
yeah,
or what he calls sociogenesis.
Yeah, and in the end, even these stages, now people are talking about U-shaped development, double U-shaped development.
Yeah, I mean, even though you have that, the critical question,
yeah,
which is what we're working on now, is where do you find the source of development, whether it's U-shaped or not?
Mm-hmm.
Is it in the biology? Is it in learner internal? Or is it in the environment? Is it a sociogenetic process, or is it a cognitive process?
Okay.
Right? Okay. A neurocognitive process.
Yes.
And Vygotsky's argument is that it's a sociogenetic process, that the origins of development are to be found in the environment, in the culture, not inside the person.
Okay, very well. Now, any SLA theory requires a theory of language in addition to a theory of acquisition or development. So what are the linguistics, the linguistic foundations of SCT?
Yeah, that was, I think, a legitimate criticism that was made of our early research, largely by Roz Mitchell in her the early initial volume of her book on second language theories, that we didn't have a theory of language. However, if you look at Vygotsky's writings, he had a lot to say about language. Of course, being influenced by the linguistics of his time, right? So to some extent, Saussure, who was the dominant linguist at his time, by a Russian linguist whose name was Spät, who had a lot to write about private speech. And so Vygotsky borrowed that notion from Spät and brought it into the theory. Also, he was influenced to some extent sociolinguist at the time. I can never remember his name.
It's okay. We can just
we
can put it on the screen when I edit.
Yeah. Okay. So he was influenced by the writing of sociolinguist at the time.
Mm-hmm.
However, I think because the core of Vygotsky's theory was language as a meaning-making system, so he was very interested in the semiotics of language and symbols. And so I think in contemporary terms, I think the theories that mesh very well with Vygotsky and psychology are cognitive linguistics and systemic functional linguistics, because they foreground meaning over structure. Mm. Whereas, generative linguistics is primarily about structure and serving meaning, whereas cognitive linguistics, it's structure emerging from meaning, and the same for systemic functional.
Yeah.
And so I think most of the work that we're doing now comes out of the linguistics of either cognitive linguistics or systemic functional or other theories that I think integrational linguistics, Roy Harris's ideas on language are also compatible with Vygotskian theory, because they foreground not just language, but they look at the entire communicative system. And I think Vygotsky was interested in the communicative system, that it would include gesture, body movements, and writing, of course, and other kinds of forms of communication.
Okay.